photographers from the magazine and suggesting them to the exhibition committee for shows. And so last July, our Nikita Brown show was because we had seen her first in Enfoco magazine, just as an example. So we finally got smarter and thought, why don't we call them? And maybe we can do an actual collaboration. So Cynthia's work being here and Daisha's in the front room is a result of that collaboration. Our exhibition committee looked at their fellowship award winners over the past 2 years and selected Cynthia and Daisha's work for exhibitions. So we definitely hope that this will be, or expect that this will be, an ongoing relationship. Bill and Liza, who are the two primary staff folks from Enfoco, had both hoped to be here, and then both, in the last minute, were not able to be here, unfortunately, but they send their hellos, and so we're really looking forward. They actually have an exhibition.
With the fellowship.
The new fellowship.
Yeah, so, and that one just opened yesterday, right?
Or yeah,
this week sometime, so they're a little busy. So anyway, I just wanted to also let you know that there are books of this exhibition for sale. They are $13. I guess my guess is that Cynthia will sign them for you if you like. And then I'm just going to turn it over to you because I know you have a full presentation for us.
Yeah, so. No, thank you.
Yeah,
thanks for being here. Start just saying like thank you for having me here, Blue Sky, Oregon people, Portland people, but also to Tom to host me in his home. He has been a really good company these days, looking through all the beautiful city. So I'm going to start. So this work, The Abuela's Portrait, Undocumented Mexican Grandmothers Who Lives in New York, I started doing it. Doing it as anthropologist and community organizer. I was working in Mexico as anthropologist with my background and historian. So when I came to New York City, I was working as a community organizer, basically with NGOs, grassroots organization, in Sunset Park. It's a neighborhood that mostly is Mexican and Chinese immigrants, most of them undocumented. So I was working a lot with women between her 50s and 70s. So when I started studying in ICP, the International Center of Photography, they required to do a thesis or a final project. So I was looking from some ideas, you know, what should I do for my final thesis? And I started the project with Gisela Bravo. She told me, like, Cynthia, can you take me some photos to send them to my grandchildren that I don't know, only through Skype or FaceTime? Are in Mexico. She spent 30 years in New York City undocumented. She just got back 2 years ago because she got she's dealing with health problems. So it's really bad for people who are undocumented women who are in the 70 work, you know. And she got back to Mexico. But I'm so grateful with her because I started the project with her. And in the beginning, was only portraits. Environmental portraits, and it's more like I asked them, how do you like to be represented in this portrait? You know, I wanted to take out the stereotype of how the Mexicans or women from Mexico undocumented live, or who they are, you know? And this collaborative process made them or allowed them to show themselves as they want, you know? I told them, imagine that this photo is going to be shown in an exhibition that is happening, or in a magazine that also happened, in a newspaper, and they choose their own outfit, and we choose together a place in their home. Sometimes it's a small apartment, so most of the time you are going to see photos in the bedroom, and the people were asking me why the bedroom is because we don't have enough space. They don't have it, you know, most are a one bedroom to sleep. It's the only private space. And some of them are between their 50 to 70. I have one that is super young, is in her 40s. But some of them does they used to clean houses, most of them, but now because they are like a little more older, they sometimes have self-employed, like they pick garbage in the streets, you know, for like bottles, work in flea markets, or sell candies in the streets. She, for example, Paulina, has her own beauty salon at her home because it's less expensive, so you can have, you know, you can have the community that don't have so much money can afford this kind of beauty salon, underground beauty salons. And Juanita has a flea market, and she's a karaoke singer. And yeah, and she earns money to play in different restaurants around Brooklyn and Queens in New York. She has a beautiful voice also. And I met her in a karaoke, and I spoke with her about, oh, I have this project about grandmothers. I wanted that you be in my project. And we became little by little friends, and she accepted. And she's the youngest one, Magda. And I met her when I was working as a community organizer. And one day I met her in the street, and she was with a little baby. And she said, it's my granddaughter. And I said, you are in my project right now. You don't have to have a process. For example, this one that is the sexy grandma, so Lupe Cantara, I said, you are going to see her later, no? Because I want to pass this one because you can, you already saw this portrait. This one, for example, I just seen up, but she's a particular grandma because she came like 20 years ago and by her own, and all her family, the nuclear family, is in Mexico. She has been supporting their son and her daughter, and now her grandchildren. So she wants to come back to Mexico, but because she lives alone in a basement, but she's still like, it's difficult to go back to Mexico because economically, when you support your family, your entire family, it's not easy. If you have questions, please do let me know. It's more like a conversation. And this project, Abuelas, is in three chapters. The first chapter is environmental portraits, you know, like that is about gender, about women, about abuelas, about the interior decoration. You can see a lot of kind of details, how they live, you know, the relationship that they have with their own spaces. It's a microcosmos. Yeah, universe at some points in their own homes, no? When the people sometimes say that the immigrants will live in the shadows, you can see here like it's not true at all, no? We decorate our own homes with memory, with objects that mean something, you know? So this is the first part, no? The first chapter. And the second chapter, I was collecting four archival materials that they brought when they cross the border, or photos that they took recently, they arrived to New York City. So I start to create a familial album. I think that now is going to turn in another phase because I have been looking many familial albums from immigrants, so maybe I want to do another project about the immigrant and Mexican immigration in New York through the family album. That it could be more interesting. So yeah, I just scanned some of these photos. Like this one is handmade. Handmade painting, and I was like concerned. Or my question was like, when you cross the border, I didn't cross the border, but when the people cross the border, most of the time they don't bring documents like ID, but they brought photos. You know why? Why these kind of things are important for them? Why these kind of things mean something for them? Is the photo of her first communion and the photo of her sweet 15s. So we have another sweet 15 photo. And this is photos from the daily life in New York City. And for me, it's like trying to also to understand that when we speak about the subjects, the people that we photograph, for me, it's no subjects. We use all the time this kind of term in sociology or anthropology, no? But they are not a passive people. They are our collaborators. They collaborate with us. Everything is about them. If they don't want to be photographed, if they don't allow me to be in their homes, I don't have project, you know? So also the Abuelas project is to honor them, You know, nobody's speaking about the undocumented grandmothers. We speak about the dreamers or the undocumented parents, but no, what is going to happen with these women who came and basically they give, spend their whole life in the United States working really hard, and at the end, they don't have anything. They cannot be retired. They pay taxes, you know? And we have some kind of issues in the Mexican culture that we waste a lot of money doing sweet 15 years, but we don't earn money. You know, we don't have money in our accounts to for the future. We don't think sometimes like Jewish people that to be retired and all. So yeah, this project, the second chapter, is also to look back in time, who they were, who they are, was, what kind of work they used to do. And this is Gisela Bravo, remember, with the giraffes, the women with the giraffes. This is Honorina, she crossed the border when she was 55, I think so. And basically, she's from Oaxaca. Basically, the whole nuclear family lives in New York, and her daughters told her, like, we are not going to get back to Oaxaca. You have to come across the border. And she crossed the border with one of her daughter and her grandson. For a kind of materials. This is Irma, that the woman who has a tree, Christmas tree, that is in the photo in front of the car, the photo book. And well, this is the archival materials. The second chapter is like documenting the daily life of these women. How is the reality? The first chapter is how they want to be seen, and the second was back in time, you know, and the third was like most documenting the daily life. Like, for example, the 60 grandmother has kidney problems. She goes to dialysis treatment every three days, three times per week. And because that, she cannot afford any kind of job because they don't going to allow her to go away so many hours to go to her treatment. So she sells candles in the streets. And yeah, Paris, Juanita and Don Carlos. Photos of their grandchildren, their works. Gisela used to work in a factory for 30 years, and when she decided to come back to Mexico was because she was earning like around $200 per week, that in New York is nothing, working 8 hours or 9 hours in a factory sewing, you earn depending what the production that you do. So something about interior decoration, I am really fascinated that I have been like seeing a lot of editors that are looking my work or look my work are telling me like you should do a essay, a project only about interior decoration without people, because they really have a sense of place. And this is like the third part, more like photojournalist style. This is Doña Lupe, that is with a cat. And also, like, for me, doing portraits or spend time with people that I document is so, you have to have a lot of empathy. And you have to be really concerned about the others, how, you know. And doing portraits is one of the first, I think, in a humble point of view, one of the first skills that you have to have, you know, to have empathy with the people. To make them feel comfortable and humanize them at some point, you know? It's not like, this is one of my favorite photos of Guadalupe. Let me go back. And also in this project, I incorporate videos, like cinema verite videos. I wanted to show more like what kind of life they live, what kind of things they do, but without editing. So this is Gisela Bravo cooking.
And also I want to share something with you that I wrote and some songs that also I took from some Susan Sontag book on photography. And one of the things that I like is like that I put it here to read it is like photographic image, which now provide most of the knowledge people have about the look of the past and the reach of the present, no? And one of the things about the third chapter is to create also a visual statement, you know, to provide like three different perspectives of the same issue. Since 2012, my partner in crime was an ex-Catholic priest because we married. Now he's a Lutheran priest. and we live in San Jacobi Church that most of the congregation is Chinese, Cantonese and Mandarin, and Mexican. So we have a lot of parties in the basement of the church. So Juanita with her partner Don Carlos and her they have a lot of grandchildren as well. This, her is my goddaughter. No, yeah, goddaughter, yeah. So, also I was interested to document Patty, so. This is Doña Gisela sewing. This is the thing that I was saying, the self-employed, the people pick garbage in the street and so they can sell it. And also Doña Gisela is a healer. To give her advisors about the take care of her health. I don't know how to say this kind of thing that she does.
Copy. What was she treating the patient for?
Hip problems.
Say it again?
Hip problems. Yeah.
And when I was, like, Doña Gisela was a really well-known healer in the Mexican community, not only in Sonsonpar where she is based, also in Queens, Bronx. So the people, when she go back, the people were really concerned about who is going to be your healer, you know, because she doesn't charge you so much. She depends, you know. They work with undocumented people mostly, so. Yeah, she knows about herbs, she's a midwife. So, yeah, I was really sad when she decided to go back to Mexico because we couldn't finish the project. But, and this is Santa Regio. Sorry. And this character, the sexy grandma, I am still in touch with her and we are still like working in the project. And she's a really amazing character. She is an actress also, a karaoke singer, and a dancer. So even though she has, you know, kidney problems, dialysis, it's really hard. She all the time is so happy, so she's a powerful woman. And I have been spent so many time with her and learning a lot of things about the life, about being a woman, and at her age, so. I recall this. In one bedroom, she does everything. It's like small bedroom, and it's a table when she eats. Because in New York is expensive, so even if you are not an undocumented immigrant, the people share an apartment. So for undocumented immigrants, it's worse, but it's like natural. This is Juanita in Halloween with her daughter. It's like a vignettes of fragments of their life without, I think that I put something, you know, but it's without editing anything, just like fragment. And this is the karaoke where Cantarrecio Guadalupe just, you know, go usually on Saturdays or Fridays. Guadalupe with her nieto? Grandson, sorry. So I think that this is all the presentation. I don't miss anything. So you want to make questions, you have thoughts, you have an opinion, please do let me know. Yeah, it was a coincidence. Most of the immigrants who are based in New York City are from Puebla. Now we have different, like people from Guerrero, from Oaxaca, from Hidalgo, from Tlaxcala, but mostly the immigrants are from Puebla. from La Mixteca. Yeah, that's the reason. It's like in Chicago, you have people from Zacatecas or Michoacán or Guanajuato, del Bajío. So the immigration, the people, is different. Yeah.
So I think you said that a lot of the women are living alone, that their families are back in Mexico. Is that true? That would you say a majority?
Yeah, it's a mix. Some families have their nuclear family. Some of the women have their nuclear family, the entire nuclear family, and some extended family in New York City. But some of them is a mix. They have two daughters in New York City and one son in Mexico. Some of them have their, or like the Ayotzinapa grandmother is here. She has the entire nuclear family in Mexico. So it's difficult because not only the deportation separate the family, it's the immigration itself that separates your family. You have to leave your country because you don't have another kind of opportunities in your hometown that provide you economically have a better life. So I know like most of them haven't seen their moms, for example, for 30, 20 years. It's hard, it's difficult.
But they don't try to, you said some of the women have returned?
No, most of them, no. And when you return and you're undocumented, you can come back, but you have to cross the border again. And nowadays, crossing the border costs a lot of money. You know, in the 90s was maybe 1,000, 2,000, now it's 8,000. It's so much money. And you have to take a lot of risk because the narcos basically control the border. And even if you have a good coyote, you have to pay to the narcos just for, you know, being their territory. So it's difficult, little by little it's more difficult. I know people that are crossing the border or they ask, sometimes they leave their children there and over the time, like Juanita, she crossed the border with her husband and she left two children of her born in the United States, but three of them in Mexico. And like after 10 years living in New York City, she paid to a coyote to bring their children to her, with her. It's hard also. You know, the children never forget that kind of things. One of her daughters told me, now imagine that you one day you wake up and your mom is not there. So, yes.
So what reaction do they get from seeing their pictures? Are these treasured possessions? Will you show them their pictures? Do they want copies?
Yeah, they have copies of all of these photos, yeah. And they have been in many exhibitions or presentation with me speaking about them and their scent and the process of the project. Unfortunately, they couldn't come to Portland, but in the spirit they are. But yeah, everything that I do, they know. And they are so proud. They are like, they are so proud to be in the project. And most of the time when I do projects, when I try to build a new project, I ask the people where I collaborate, do you like it? What do you think? Do you think it's important to do these kind of things? Because I wanted that they really like the project. It's for them also, not only for my career or build a career. Obviously I want to get my photos in different outlets, but also I want the people that I am collaborated them feel happy with the result, and my world wants to transform me. One of the goals is to transform their lives or their thoughts, empower them through photography, through art. So yeah, and I have most of them on Facebook, so if I put something, they know. Yeah.
Yes.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the transition from your anthropology work to this photography. I mean, I can see the relationship, obviously, but then, you know, what made you really move into photography, and what did you do when you realized, like, oh, I want to be a photographer?
Yeah, thank
work.
You.
Yeah. When I was in Mexico, I spent like 1 year living in a village, in a small village, it's an indigenous village. So most of the people there, this is the reason because I came to New York. Most of the people, the men used to go to New York to work with in a Korean restaurants with Italians, mostly Korean and Italians, yes. So when I was living there, I was taking photos, and some of my professors saw one of my photos, and he said, "You have talent." And I started taking my photos as anthropologist, but I was really bad and amateur, no? So I went to New York in 2011 to finish my dissertation in indigenous immigration in New York. So little by little, I become more in love with photography. And when I was working as a community organizer, I got this kind of feeling to come back to the academia or to come back to do more creative things. So I found in documentary photography a lot of similitudes to, like, for example, like you do field work in photography as well as you do in anthropology. You have to speak with people, listen to people as well, do notes. It's so similar. But I was thinking to do a PhD, and I was realized like I don't want to spend like 6 years only in a library. I want to be with people, and photography allows you to be with people, even though you don't earn a lot of money. I don't encourage you to do it. Be a lawyer or architecture, and you know, later maybe as a hobby photography. But yeah, this was a transition, and I was noticed that, oh, now I have the skills. When I was studying ICP, I don't want to say the best, but I was with more skill than my classmate doing research or thinking about immigration because my background. So now I am thinking to come back to the school to study fine arts, but I want to try to push my work more like fine arts. I think that immigration issue has been told. The narration is in cinema, in anthropology, sociology, in photo. It's the issue now, immigration, more in this country. So I want to, like this work, as this work, I want to try to create a body of work, more body of works that change the narrative, you know, of who we are as an immigrants. That's my goal, through the art also. And yeah, now I am trying to be more close to fine arts or learn more about artists who are doing like Desha, no? More fine arts in combination with documentary or history or anthropologies. Like using all of these skills to create something new, something more interesting.
Since you have these three chapters to this project, have you had an opportunity where in one exhibition you've presented all three?
Not yet. I got a fellowship with Magnum Foundation, and they have been telling me, like, Cinta, we should do an exhibition. But all the time I am like, I am not ready, it's not ready. I have this kind of sense in my own work, and it's a self-critique, like, it's not ready still, it's not ready. But maybe, yeah, soon, I need to finish it. Now I start a new project about undocumented Mexican musicians that is going to be, I am super excited about it. So yeah, it could be a possibility to show it. I have been published in Open Society Foundation, the third chapter was published. They do a takeover on their Instagram. So I did that, yeah. And I don't know. You want to know more? You want to more, to see one another thing?
Something from the
something for another project?
Yeah. Yeah.
Do we have time? Do you want?
Sure.
Okay, let me see. So I am working in this project about, you know, sanctuary, you know? Now because the environment that we are living in this country, a lot of people are taking sanctuary, people that are facing deportation. Immigrants, the last opportunity that they have to fight their deportation and stay with their family and their kids is
refugee in a church to fight inside in the church for with lawyers and community and faith leaders for her against their deportation. So I am going to show you a video. I am working with kids. Now it's interesting with grandmothers, but also I am so close with people that between 60, 70, 80, 50. It's something that maybe I didn't know you. It's like also this project that Abuelas is so personal because I didn't have in my family the role, this role. I didn't have an abuelita. So yeah, one day I realized like, oh, this is more personal project that I think. So let me see. So I started this project in collaboration with some of my friends. Two of them, one of them is the producer of Democracy Now! And the other is an anthropologist. And we are doing, for the Nation magazine, different kind of series about people taking sanctuary. So this one, I did it with, this is the one that I did with them. It's about, it's a Guatemalan woman who took sanctuary in New York City, the first one, with her three children, Dulce, Daniela, and David. I'm going to show you today the video. And I start working with one of her daughters. Her name is, let me see, what is it? Dulce Carvajal. So I gave her a camera, a Polaroid, and a digital camera, and she started taking photos about what does it mean to be in sanctuary. So I encouraged the girl to take her own photos and also to write a statement about what does it mean to be in sanctuary. And her photos and her paper were published in the Nation magazine, that I told her is a big deal for a 10 years old girl. So, and we made together a multimedia piece that I'm going to show you now.
How old is she? That's talking
10.
It's crazy, amazing video.
Let me see the other. So we made her own statement that she wrote for the Nation magazine. We edit the statement to put it in the multimedia piece. And the photos are by myself, made by myself.
Once upon a time, there was a girl named Dulce. She had a mom who was going to get deported because of Mr. Trump. He doesn't like people who don't have papers for the United States. So on August 17, the mom was going to go to New York City to go to the court. But she didn't go because she knew she was going to get sent to Guatemala. So she decided to go to a church with her three kids named Dulce, Daniela, and David. The oldest one, that was Dulce, knew a little bit more about what was going on, but the younger ones didn't really know that much. But actually, second birthday was the mom's birthday, and the third birthday was David's birthday. There was balloon pinata, super candy in the pinata. There was also face mats with sticks of Mickey Mouse and cake, messing with your music, eating food, and also eating a lot of candy. David's birthday was really fun. Dorothy thinks that her mom is going to be a papers for the United States because what Trump is doing is not fair. Deporting people who don't have their papers like Dorothy's mom. Dorothy really wants her mom to get the papers because she still doesn't want to be stuck in the church. If her mom gets her papers, Dorothy wants to travel everywhere. She wants to travel to Florida to go to Disneyland, and she wants more places to go to.
Powerful, no?
Yeah.
Do you hear well? Because the audio wasn't really good.
Post it. Yeah, post it online if you could.
I don't know, you have more questions or thoughts or opinions or
do more of that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.